Welcome to the August 2015 online video recording for the Microsoft partners who attended the first half of 2015 OEM server roadshow. So as we discussed in the first video recording, these are really designed to give you updates of what's new, what's changing, and what you need to be aware of in the OEM server team so that you can be more up to date with changes that are happening, because obviously we do have new versions of Windows Server coming up, and we want to make sure that you are very well armed and prepared for when those new versions come along, so that you do have a large amount of information at your disposal to make sure that you can start delivering fantastic solutions as soon as your customers do start demanding these new technologies. So if we take a look at the agenda that we've got for today, we'll talk about the Windows Server 2016 Essentials Tech Preview 3, and then we'll start taking a look at some of the capabilities around the Windows 10 cloud integration pieces, especially leveraging off what we do inside of Essentials in terms of assigning the appropriate licenses. So I'll do a demonstration of this as well, so you'll be able to see this in action and see just, you know, a quick preview of some of the capabilities that we'll start digging into in a lot more detail in future sessions. Then we'll switch over to have a quick conversation around some of the upcoming events, including some where you'll get to meet members of the local OEM team. And then we'll wrap up with the three critical resources from the local OEM team so that you know where to go and who to contact to start getting more information. So let's jump in and take a look at what's happening with Windows Server Essentials, the Tech Preview 3. So there's an evaluation version of this available, and I guess the good news is for anyone who's already familiar with Windows Server 2016 Essentials, or sorry, 2012 R2 Essentials, or if you're familiar with Windows Server Essentials experience inside of the Standard or Data Center editions, you'll be very comfortable as soon as you've got this up and running. So that's fantastic news. It means that, you know, the look and feel is the same, the features that you're used to are still there. But the other thing though is that there are some new capabilities that are starting to be added that really give you an indication of the direction and the strategy that Microsoft is taking here. So you'll see things around, and I'll show you this during the demonstration. So even though we did have the integration with Azure backup in the previous version, we're now at the point where additional Azure backup options are being, Azure connectivity options are being provided. So the first one is the Azure Virtual Network integration, and I'll demonstrate this to you during the lab so you can actually see how this works. So I've got a demonstration of that which I've recorded, which I'll show you. And also moving on, we've also got the capability to start leveraging the Azure Site Recovery capabilities. So with Azure Site Recovery, it means that we can start replicating our VMs and physical machines into Azure VMs, so that if we do have to do a network recovery inside of another environment, we can have these pre-staged and ready to go inside of Azure. So with this is something that we'll focus on in a future update. But for this one, we'll focus on, you know, some of the existing capabilities that you may have had a chance to use inside of 2012 R2, but we'll also take a look at the Azure Virtual Network integration so you can start getting ideas of some of the different things that maybe you may be capable of delivering with that. So let's jump in now and take a look at the demonstration of this. So here I'm inside of a virtual machine running Windows Server 2016 Tech Preview 3, as you can see here. So what I'll just do now is walk you through just a few things so you can see what's the same, what looks a bit different. And mind you, at this point, they haven't released a full set of details in terms of all of the capabilities. So let's just go through and take a look at some of the things. First of all, starting off with the Windows Server Essentials dashboard. Now, if you were at the roadshow, you would have seen some of these details previously, but you can see that it's got the same look and feel. So it's broken down into the same categories across the top. Down the bottom, we've got setup, services, quick status, and help. What we'll focus on for this one is we'll start off just with the services. And you can see here that we've got the Azure AD, Office 365, and Intune integration, along with the Azure backup integration capabilities that we had in the past. But what we've also got is the Azure Virtual Network and the Azure Recovery pieces. So to begin with, just let me go through and configure the Azure Active Directory integration. And that should be a fairly short process. So we just choose Integrate with Azure AD. I'll just provide my sign-in details. Now, this account needs to be a global admin in your Office 365 or is your Active Directory environment. And I'll just click on Next. We need to apply a strong password policy because obviously we don't want weak passwords either on-prem or especially up in the cloud. Now you'll see that it started populating information in terms of what it's retrieved. So we've got quite a few details down on the right hand side around the different subscriptions in terms of the number of licenses that have been consumed. So we can see the number that are available, we can see the expiry dates, we can see the primary DNS details, etc. But also just in the wizard itself, you can see that it just gives a quick view that I've got two different subscriptions here. I've got the Office 365 E3 plan, and I've also got the Enterprise Mobility Suite, which as you'll see in a few moments, includes Intune is your Active Directory Premium and the Rights Management Service. Now, it will tell me that I need to go through and enable the password synchronization. It tells me that I will need to restart this server, so I'll just go through and do that quickly. So I won't get you to sit there and watch that whole process, so I'll cut that out of the recording and then we'll come back in after the server has been restarted. Okay, this might actually start up quicker than I thought, so maybe I don't need to cut anything out. So we'll just let this run for a little bit longer. And now we're back at the login screen for the server, so let's go back in and we'll go back into the Essentials dashboard. And what I'll also do here is just enable the Office 365 integration component and the Intune integration component. So now that we've already enabled the Azure AD integration, it means integrating Office 365 is a simple process. It realizes that we're already basically signed in with those details we saw previously. So we can just configure that. And what that configuration will do is just take us to the tab where we can see the Office 365 integration details. we can see some of the information around the E3 license. So we can see that this is something I'll have to renew in less than a year. We can see email details here. Now, if I go back to the homepage, what we can then do is go back to services, and now I'll enable Intune. Now, with the Intune integration piece, again, we'd be using the same user identities that we're using for Office 365 and Azure Active Directory. So it's just a matter of enabling that. But what you'll see here is that, you know, we don't have a page inside of here to manage Intune. Instead, it would tell us to go to the portal. So the next steps are to go through and add a new user in. So I've already got my own account in there. So let's go through and add a new user account, and I'll call it Essentials User, and I'll give them a complex password. And it looks like everything matches. Now, what you'll see here is that I've still got the ability to go through and choose which, what do I want as the sign-in slash email address for that user. And obviously, it's going to be better for the user if I do use the real URL or domain name rather than the onmicrosoft.com. But alternatively, I could go through and assign an existing user account to that one. So if I've already got a few users set up in that environment, I could assign them to that user account. Or I could choose not to assign it because it may just be an on-premises user who doesn't need that account. So I'll just click Next on that and create the new account. This way we get to pick and choose all of the licensing capabilities for the user. So in this case, what we don't want is we don't want the Azure Rights Directory capabilities, and we also don't want the Office 365 Intune capabilities, because instead we'll use the full MDM capabilities of Intune that we've got here. So the other options look okay, so I'll just I'll get rid of that one and enable that one. So we'll just go next. This is just an end user, so that they don't need access to the server dashboard, but we can still give them remote web access. So important to note, remote web access is still in Essentials 2016. So now we go through, it connects into the cloud service, it will create the user and then go through multiple steps of assigning all of those individual licenses out to that user. So if you're adding multiple users, you can see that it's something that really will start saving a bit of time for you. Now, just to see what's going on with the Essentials user, what we can see first of all from the dashboard is we can see, you know, that they're in here as a standard user, and they also do have an Office 365 account there as well, and we can sort of very easily see what the details are. Now, just to verify that I have given the Essentials user the right permissions or the right licenses inside of Office 365 and the Enterprise Mobility Suite, let's just take a look in here and see what we've got. So again, this is all dynamic. It's querying the service to get a real-time view of what this user has actually got available to them. So this is something that can take a few seconds depending on internet connectivity speeds. Because I've just provisioned the user as well, it may also just take a few extra seconds for it to complete the processes that I just initiated a minute or so ago. So we'll just give that another few seconds to run, and then we will be able to see what's happening with that. Okay, so here we are. So you can see here, if I wanted to add additional email addresses, I could do that. So if we did have multiple domain names that we were using for external communications, I could easily add those into this environment. Now, we can also see that those different licenses that I have assigned are also available in here as well. So that's all well and good. So I can hit OK. So now it's a matter of moving on to something that's new inside of here, which is the Azure virtual networking. So I won't cover Azure backup or Azure recovery in this this month's update. We'll save that for a future one. Instead, let's just take a look at the Azure virtual networking so you can get an understanding of some of the scenarios where you may want to look at this. So first of all, I want to integrate with Azure virtual network. And in this case, you know, we don't need to use that same ID to sign in. We may be using a different ID to sign into our Azure overall tenant to what we've got as a global admin for Azure. So in this case, I'm going to use a different sign-in, but you can still see that it's an onmicrosoft.com email address, sign-in account. And I do have multiple Azure subscriptions set up here, so I'll just choose the first one, Visual Studio Premium one, because I've actually done a little bit of work in advance to speed this process up. So what we can do here is, first of all, choose where we want the virtual network to be. And in this case, I'm Sydney-based, so I'll choose Australia East. And for the Azure virtual network, one that I created in advance was called TP3 Test for Tech Preview 3 Test. And the local network that I'd already configured was TP3 Local. So these are ones that, once I've completed this, you'll see the settings that it automatically chose. So I didn't have to do, you know, any configuration of IP, for example, to get this working. Instead, it just said, do I want to use my Windows server as the VPN server, or do I have a hardware device that will need to be configured as the VPN server into Azure via a site-to-site network. So I'll just hit OK on that one. And here we can see use Windows Server as the VPN server or use my VPN router. I'll keep it simple here and I'll just select Windows Server. So now as I click on Finish here, we can see that inside of Azure, it's got the virtual network address space of 10.0.0.0 all the way through to the 255 range. So obviously it's quite a large range, and you can go into the Azure portal online and start breaking that down into smaller subnets if you want. So there's no problem whatsoever with you doing that. And any of you who've already played around with Azure virtual networking will already be quite familiar with how to do that. Now you can also see here what my local network address space is. You can see the local DNS server, which is this system itself, as well as the local public IP address. So I'll just hit OK on that. So now it's going through and configuring this. And this can take a couple of minutes to run. So to sort of show you before and after, just let me open up a command prompt. And I'll also fire up remote desktop. A remote desktop client, because I've already got a virtual machine provisioned up inside of Azure. So while that's being provisioned, if I try to ping that server, you can see that nothing's happening. I'm not able to get through to it. If I try to use remote desktop services to get through to it, so what you'll see here is that I actually did get a response on that final one, so it's connected. It's telling me, you know, over the life cycle of the connection, how much data has already been transferred. Now, just to really give you an idea of what's going on here, if I just ping that, okay, we'll see that we've got this one. Now, if I go over to this machine here, and I again type in the domain admin details, what I'm showing you here is that this is a, because I'd already had this network running before I went through this scenario for you and disconnected it and then reconnected, I've kind of jumped ahead a few steps, but I've done that deliberately so you can actually see that the remote server that I've connected into that's sitting inside of Azure is actually already, you know, I've already gone through, I've done a domain join with that, for example. So if this is a workload that I wanted to run inside of Azure that I didn't want to run on-premise, for example, because there are a whole bunch of different Azure virtual machine templates that you may find useful, or different workloads that you do want to run remotely, this is a very easy way for you to go through and get that set up. So you can see that I'm able to RDP into it using the internal IP address, whereas normally if you're setting something up inside of Azure and not connecting the networks, you'd need to be connecting into it via the public IP address and a differently mapped port for getting into RDP access. So if I just minimize this, the other thing that I'll show you now that we've got, you can see that I've already got a domain joined machine in here. What I can also do now is go through, if I go back to the start menu and I select Server Manager, because we've essentially got this set up as a site-to-site VPN connection, I've only got one server. I've got the essential server added in here at the moment. What I can do now is go up to the dashboard. I can add another server to manage, and you can see here that, you know, because this is a domain joined server, so I can add the server in And you know, obviously this is one of the things that we focused on a bit during the roadshow. Now that's a server that I can go through and manage and launch the management tools from within this local server that I'm administering. So if I go into Active Directory, well, I've only got one AD server, so I'm only going to get reports from one. But that other server, it really doesn't have too much on it apart from some file services. So what you can see here is that I can now go through and perform the file management. So if I go down to disks, okay, and we can see for server one, if I do a refresh on this. You can see here that now that secondary server that I set up, if I want to go through and do some disk configuration, see how much storage is available. If I wanted to enable data deduplication, I could go through and remotely start configuring that. So there's quite a bit that we can do now that we've got the Azure virtual networking environment connected into our own local network. So effectively, from a user perspective, if they're on our local domain, they can go through and connect into local resources and these remote Azure resources. The only real difference is going to be the speed of what it is they're trying to achieve over the high-speed local network versus what the customer internet connectivity speed will be. So that ends the Windows Server Essentials portion. And I just wanted to give you a quick overview of some of the little changes, some of the things that are new, but also showing you that, as you'd expect, based on conversations we've been having for the last couple of years, the big message here when we do look at Essentials or we look at Windows Server, it's not a cloud versus an on-prem conversation. It's how do you leverage the benefits of on-prem, how do you manage the benefits of cloud-based services, and bring them together as a better solution for your customers. So let's get out of the Windows Server portion of the demonstration now. So now moving on to the cloud integration services that Essentials starts providing, and how can we start leveraging these with Windows 10? So while there are a few different scenarios, the primary one I want to highlight for you during the next demonstration is really showing you how you can take Windows 10 Pro or Enterprise devices that you're going through that first run experience or UBI or out-of-box experience, and one of the things it provides you is the ability to go through and not just do a typical domain join or set up a local account, but you can also go through the process of joining an Azure Active Directory domain as well. So this means that you've got the ability to go through and register the device, and all of a sudden it means that you can start getting some mobile device policies starting to be applied down to that device. So if you think about the usage scenarios for this, it's really all about devices that it may be a BYOD device that users don't want to join the corporate domain, but from a policy and requirements perspective, you may still want to start providing or enforcing things like a 4-digit PIN or a 6-digit PIN, just to at least ensure that there is some degree of security over a device that does have corporate access. Now, the other thing we can start doing in here is as we did during that last scenario, where I did assign Intune licenses to the users. If the users do have Intune licenses assigned and I assign and they do a device registration or the Azure AD join, one of the things that will happen or can happen automatically if you allow it to occur is it can also now automatically enroll that device in Intune for you. So it means that there's less overhead, less administration, and that device can start getting some much more complex scenarios around user identity, device identity, location awareness, as well as mobile application control. All you have to do is really set the back-end policies, and as new devices are added to Azure AD, they'll automatically start picking these up, and Intune will then push them down to that. So let's move on to the demonstration where you'll see a brief version of this, but as I've mentioned, we'll dig into some of these things in a lot more detail as we move through future activities. So now on a Windows 10 virtual machine that's just finishing up the out-of-box experience, one of the offerings that we get at the moment on Windows 10 Pro and Windows 10 Enterprise devices is we get a chance of actually either signing into an organization account at the beginning or saying that it's our own personal device. Now, if I select my organization, what this means is that it will give me the option of going through and either signing into a traditional Active Directory domain, so signing into our normal domain, doing the PC domain join for us, or alternatively, we can join Azure Active Directory. Now, where this is important is if we've got Windows 10 devices such as this one that really aren't going to be on the corporate network, or it might be more of a BYOD type scenario, this means that we can actually start getting some mobile device management capabilities pushed out to the device either by some of the combinations that you can get through Azure Active Directory. Microsoft Office 365 includes a subset of Intune MDM capabilities, as well as Intune itself's capabilities. So in this case, if I choose Join Azure AD, what I'll do here is I'll sign in as that user. So remember that the user that I used in that last example was Essentials User at emsauspoc.com. And the password was a complex one, so hopefully I've typed that in correctly. Now, what you'll see here is that I've already done some customized branding in this Azure AD or Office 365 tenant, where it's already going through and actually providing me like just a small logo and a little bit of customized text that might make it a bit more assuring for customers that they are doing the right thing when they're signing in. So then I just click sign in. And if all of the networking is configured properly, etc., for us at this point in time, it means that we should be able to go through and have a device that we can automatically enroll in Azure AD using the Azure AD device join capability. So that means that things like mobile device policies that will enforce password complexity, whether you want alphanumeric or just PIN, how complex you want them, if you want like a 4-digit PIN versus 6-digit PIN, that's really just the tip of the iceberg in terms of what you can actually do here. So here you can see that now it's welcoming me as this user. So this has successfully set me up in this case. And now it needs to go through and do the normal Windows 10 application or built-in apps setup, etc., do a few customizations. So this won't take too long. So we'll just pause this while this occurs, and then we'll come back in as we've gotten to the end of this. So you don't need to watch this entire process. Now, the first thing that I need to do is to create a work PIN. So I can go through and just say create the PIN. So we can see that little message that popped up just gave us information that the machine was about to be registered. So here we can take a look at what the PIN requirements are. We can see minimum length is 4. And basically you can see that letters aren't allowed. So we're only enforcing 4-digit PINs. So I can just select a 4-digit PIN here. And these are policies that over on the online services side, I can make much more complex if I need to. But if we're really just trying to get people used to the idea of some of this, we may not want to start things too complex to begin with. So that's it. So that's an out-of-box setup. So I can just now go through, and if we take a look at the settings here, the way that we can tell that this is actually now a device that is joined is if I go to About in System, you'll see here that it's telling me that I'm connected to the organization. Now, what I just want to highlight here, though, is that if you go to the traditional area where you can find this information, such as going into System, you'll see here that it's still technically in a work group. So even though it's done in Azure Active Directory domain join, that's not the same as a machine ID being associated and a user ID being associated with your on-premise Active Directory. So this is an alternative way of getting devices enrolled and registered and starting to get some capabilities over them without them having to be participating in your local network security. Instead, it's cloud-based network security that's being delivered. So that's just a really quick look at what I wanted to show you here. So we'll go back to the presentation. So let's switch gears now and talk about some of the upcoming events. So we've got a few, even though it's three categories here, there's actually more than that if we take a look. But the first one, and I guess the big one, is the Ignite Australia. So some of you may remember this. It's basically the reincarnation of the event known as TechEd for many, many, many years, which I know quite a few of you, including myself, have been to on many, many occasions. But this is a four-day event up on the Gold Coast. You can't register for this event just yet, but you can go through and register your interest so that when they do open up for registration, you can be one of the first to hear about it. And this is, you know, a four-day event, so it's a bit different to your normal go for a day or two. There is going to be travel involved for a lot of people because it is on the Gold Coast in Queensland. Now, moving on to the next ones, we've got 3 days Windows 10 deep dive training. So this is happening towards the end of September. So just before anyone looks at the dates for Melbourne and Brisbane here and goes, hang on, they're on the same day. That's correct. So there'll be different teams delivering these depending on where you are, which one you go to. But there's one in Sydney on the 23rd to 25th of September, in Melbourne from the 28th to the 30th, and in Brisbane on the 28th to 30th as well. So obviously it's not the same people delivering the 28th to 30th ones in Melbourne and Brisbane on the same days. And now finally, moving on to, I guess the series that's going to be very important for those of you who are, you know, trying to keep up to date with what Microsoft's doing with Windows Server 2016, and those of you, in Windows 10 and Office 365 and the other different online services. There are four confirmed rounds of events so far. Some of them are in two cities, some of them go up to five cities. But I'll just give you a quick explanation of what the different ones are, so that you can get an idea of, you know, which ones may be of interest. But if you are interested, you know, go to the Oz OEM team blog site and you'll just scroll through and you'll find links to these so that you can register early to make sure that, you know, you can get a seat here. So the first up with Connect with Customers, this is really focused around, you know, leveraging online services from a customer perspective. So, you know, being able to, you know, collaborate with people, leveraging things like CRM solutions, etc. So the updated content the topics are starting to appear now. The first update information went out this morning. So we're just waiting to see what actually gets locked in, but it's all good new refreshed information from the last time these were delivered. Now there's Safeguard Your Business, which focuses more on, you know, securing information coming in and out of Office 365, securing Windows 10 devices, making sure that you do have, you know, good backup strategies in place using something like Azure Offsite Backup, for example. Moving to Grow Efficiently, this is really about, you know, how do you take it to the next step? So do you need to start looking at virtualization options? Do you need to start leveraging cloud solutions? So Grow Efficiently is really where you'll start learning more about that. And with Business Anywhere, this is focused on, you know, looking at users in terms of, you know, people who aren't necessarily sitting at a desk all day using a desktop PC. They're people who may be using different devices in different locations over the course of a day. They may be able to pull out the device of their choice sitting in a cafe at lunchtime and still expect to be productive. So things like remote desktop services, both on-prem and the Azure remote app capabilities, for example, are some of the types of things that are covered with this. And obviously quite a few other things are going to be covered during the course of the day. And then finally, we're waiting on the confirmation of what's going to be included and the availability of Windows 10 one-day content. But stay tuned, that information will go up onto blogs.technet.com / Oz OEM team at some point in the future. We're just waiting on that final information. Now, what you'll see here is that quite a few of these have got asterisks next to them. And what these mean is that at this point in time, we should have some local OEM team representation at these. So if you do come along, make sure you introduce yourself. Let us know that you are an OEM reseller. Doesn't necessarily mean we'll give you a free cap or t-shirt. It would be nice, but just let us know so that we can get an idea of, you know, who's paying attention to the content and, you know, what kind of feedback you've got so that we can make it more appropriate for you. So now, moving on to the final slide. The three main resources that we like to promote from the local OEM team, it's really, the prime one is the Smart HQ site. So this is sales, marketing, and technical information. It will cover different programs, different offers that the distis and the OEMs have got in place. And it's really just designed to be this all-in-one location so that you can go there and see what's happening. So obviously, you know, a lot of information and it gets updated on a very regular basis. Now, we've also got the Australian OEM team blog site. So This is more focused on the actual technology side. So this is something that we try to get at least one or two posts up a week. So you'll see, you know, sometimes there are so many updates during a week that it's hard to keep track of. So we, you know, we try to make sure that we've got a central location we can keep pushing people back to. Even if you're not checking it every day, you know, I'd strongly suggest, you know, add it to your RSS feed so that you can actually, you know, get an idea of how often it's changing and, you know, what type of content is there. So with this, we try to pre-filter things that are OEM and SMB reseller focused, so that you can, you know, just have this simple location rather than hunting down through, you know, all the different Microsoft online properties that there are. We just want to try to make it a little bit simpler for you, especially when it comes to, you know, things that are happening that are relevant for the Australian marketplace. And the final piece is the email that we've got for pre-sales information for Microsoft OEM server products. So this isn't a technical support alias. It's really just for those of you who've got you know, maybe sales questions or licensing questions around the OEM server products. So shoot your details through to that, or if you've got any feedback, please feel free to use that as a feedback alias as well. We do like hearing from you, because it's always great to have other people give us suggestions as to what we should be talking about, as opposed to us thinking we know what you need to hear about. So that's really it for this presentation. So thank you very much for coming online and watching this. And stay tuned. We'll have another one of these out shortly, where we'll start digging into more of the details around Windows Server 2016 previews, for standard and data center, as well as some of the changes that are occurring in virtualization. So thank you very much for joining us on this call.